So we will start from the basics. What is remote sensing? Why remote sensing? Where did it originate? How it has evolved over time? Okay. What is remote sensing? So if you are seeing me, it is remote sensing. Yes or no? If you are looking at the slide, it is remote sensing. Yes. So everything is remote sensing unless we are in contact. So that's what. So we always use remote sensing, right? How did this word originate? And what is the origin of all this? What is the origin for before remote sensing? What was it? Huh? Photography. So how did photography originate? And what is photography means? Photography meaning? Image. I want literal meaning, that word by word, what the dictionary should give. What is it? Photo is light, graphy, graph is drawing. That is what it is. You make things from light or light drawn. That is what the image is. That is what is photography. Okay, what is the origin of photography? Was it there 200, 300 years back? So 1838, Louis Daguerre was the one who evolved or who, you know, made these emulsions so that visible spectrum at least can be detected. In 1508, it was the balloon photography. Before that, there was nothing. And then finally, 1910-12, that is the time Wright brothers invented the plane. And that has given a flip. And the First World War, any progress in any discipline is because of? Progress in any discipline comes because of?
Compulsion.
What is that compulsion?
War.
War. War is the root cause of every progress and every destruction. That is it. So, 1914, the World War has given a good flip to the aerial photography. Okay, and until that time it was pigeon-tied, cameras, photography, and then balloon and all that. 1910, Wilbur Wright, that Wright brothers invented plane, then aerial photography and the World War. Of course, any technology gives an edge. It is both-sided, right? It is a two sides of a coin. It has, you know, neighbor also can see. What is it it gives? You can look into their territory, but they also have that edge. And of course, the First World War has given a good flip to aerial photography and finally leading to photogrammetry. Photography means who is interested. Finally, you should be able to interpret for the forces. That is what it is. And then finally, it went to Second World War has given beyond boundaries of visible spectrum. Infrared and all that have started. That is what, you know, our people, army, security people use. What type of clothing? Outer. Color? Green. So that green, you know, they can be, they can't. But in infrared photography, that can be differentiated because the moment you cut the branch, it loses its contact. So it can be detected in infrared photography. So that is how infrared photography got a flip in Second World War. And of course, subsequently this. All this is because of the big, why military, why war then requires this thing? What is the origin? Why war requires all this? You would like to have an edge over your neighbor or to whom you are fighting with, right? And you want to protect yourself, your society. Of course, leaving apart the expansion plans that I have to enlarge my holdings, my boundaries, whether it is my own or countries or whatever it is. Okay, so that is it. So photogrammetry came in a big way, photogrammetry. Metry is measurements. That is how it is. And later on, that turned out to be, you know, Elvin, I think I have given in the notes, Evelyn Prutt, an US naval officer in 50s, have coined this word, remote sensing. That is how it has come from photography to photogrammetry to remote sensing. That is the how this has come in. So, what is it that we can do with remote sensing? Although there are many energies like acoustics, electromagnetic spectrum, and these you know, electrical resistivity, so many. But here we exclusively deal with EMR or electromagnetic spectrum and its interactions, not beyond that. And of course there are active sensors, passive sensors. Active sensors are the ones which are microwave related, and passive sensors are the ones which normally uses sun's energy of that. Remote sensing, I think you have already talked about anything about, you know, which is not in contact, if anything. So what are the various phases of remote sensing? So it interacts with the matter, and then transmission to, this is what sun's energy comes, and then it gets absorbed, reflected, transmitted, whatever it is. Reflected energy is being detected by the low altitude aircraft or ground truth, and then mid altitude or higher altitude, and then finally satellites. This can be collected in ground truth in terms of you know, normal measurements, otherwise it could be in terms of pictures or digital data, and then have this some ground truth data, and then combine them and analyze and make the interpretable maps, so that the users or the experts can finally give the outcomes of all that. So these are the various facets of remote sensing. And then what is the origin? Origin is electromagnetic spectrum. Electromagnetic spectrum is why it is called electric and magnetic. These are mutually perpendicular directions, and that is why it is called electromagnetic spectrum. This is the spectrum that we, this energy that deals with. You can see suns, what is its temperature at the core? Temperature of the sun at the core is about 1 crore 50 lakhs degrees Celsius. What is its surface temperature? Surface temperature is about 5500 to 6000. You can see suns, that is the 6000 K. And at various K's, if you see, you can see the Earth's emission, or what do you call, it's not, you know, it absorbs and retransmits, and that is about 300 K. That's why our atmospheric temperature in general, approximately, it may slightly vary, is about 273, 300 minus 273 is about 27 degrees centigrade. That is how this 300. So is it electromagnetic energy or that? What, only sun is the capable, or anywhere else? Any other? Do we transmit energy? Yes or no? No. I mean, we don't. How do we feel warm when we wear the warm clothing? Huh? Because of what? Huh? It is not that, you know, there is always radiation. Anything above the zero, 273 K, yes or no? Should, that's it. Every living being, for that matter, even most of the non-living things also are above absolute temperature. Yes or no? So that it has to. That is what, warm clothing is not doing anything except it is preserving whatever that you are emitting. That's it. So every object which is above the absolute should emit energy. Sun, you can see at what temperature, that surface temperature, and the Earth at 300 degrees K. You can also see the maximum at what is the emission at a particular wavelength. For sun, it is about 0.5 micrometers, and for Earth, for 300, it is about 10. Why should it come? We'll come to that little later. So this electromagnetic energy, if you see, is it that all that energy that is being emitted gets transferred to the ground? Does all of that come? Absorbed, then some reflected, and some gets transmitted. Now what comes is only that much of energy. You can see the windows that you are seeing, these are only the, you know, windows through which it can come or get back. Rest of it, these are all blockages. in a natural or absolutely transparent system, that would have been actually a uniform energy source. If there is no atmosphere, everything should have been coming. If everything would have been coming, we would not have been living. These are all for our survival. Otherwise, probably UV radiation would have eaten away long back. There is no question of having anything live. So these are the things. How do they get absorbed? Ozone in ultraviolet, and in the visible and infrared spectrum, it is mainly the water, carbon dioxide. These are the things, main things which absorb. So those absorb when they open the transmit windows are shown as UV, visible, infrared, and of course this is beyond 1 mm or beyond that is microwave, higher wavelengths. Why it is called infrared here and ultraviolet? Ultra should be more or less? Ultra is? Ultra is less. Meaning of ultra? Less. Meaning of infra? Everybody agrees that? Or anybody? Meaning of ultra is more, infra is less. But if you look at the wavelength, ultra is less than the violet. And infra is more than the red. It is not in terms of wavelength, it is in terms of quantum of energy that it is ultra. Lesser the wavelength, it is more the energy. More the wavelength, it is the less the energy. That is the problem of detection at higher wavelengths. Okay? So these are the windows through which it comes through, and the visible you can see at the center. Yes or no? And that is visible range is 0.4 to 0.7. Okay, tomorrow will be our water resources, but just see, two-thirds of the globe is covered with, two-thirds of the body comprises of chance or design. If you see, the maximum transmission, including the previous one, if you see, from sun, is about 0.5. And 0.5 is in the visible spectrum, yes or no? That means maximum energy that what we can see is being received from the sun in that wavelength. Accident or design? Okay? And there are many more things that will come. So that is one important thing, because we can see in color. Do we? What is the reason? Every animal can see. The eye, of course, the new concept has slight change, supposed to contain cones and rods. Cones are less in number, rods are many more in number in terms of this. So cones discriminate color, color viewing, and the rods are for intensity of light. If rods are malfunctioning, one is night blind because he can't see the light unless it is a very bright light. Night blindness, you are aware, na? And of course, if the cones are non-functional, he becomes colorblind. That is what the traffic inspector asks us when we go for driving license. Provided, of course, it is not the other way around. When we go and if you want to test, he says, can you discriminate the color, green, red and all that. So, we are fortunate. And we can see in 3D. 3D, you know. Yes, in photogrammetry, sometimes. That is what actually this aerial photography has given a big flip, because you can see in 3D. You can measure the heights. That is the advantage. So, do the animals see in 3D? It depends. If they have a converging eyesight, it should be able to see. If they have diverging, if this nose is so big or something where I can't merge my eyesight, that is what you can see. Similarly, the color, not that all animals can see. What is it? Magarmach is, crocodile cannot see. This can only give in gray areas. Some of the birds can see. Some of the animals can see, like monkey and others, but not everything. It is the absence or presence of cones. So are we fortunate to have a 3D? 3D means both eyes should be functional. And of course, color viewing. All that. So probably we should be one of the fortunate species to. What is electromagnetic radiation? Quantum. Is it wave theory is acceptable or quantum theory? H into nu is Q is equal to quantum theory. C is equal to lambda into mu is the wave physics. Are they, both are okay? Particulate theory or particulate physics and the wave theory? Both may lead to same thing, but you can't say that is only that or this. So what is the truth? Truth is unknown. What we know is only interaction, whether it is in remote sensing or something. What is interaction? When I interact, then is how you judge real color or anything. That can we see the real color? What is the color of that curtain? Approximately. It doesn't matter whether it. Yes? Huh? Red. Okay, red. But is that the true color? It's true color? So what is the true color? If it is no, what is the true color? If it is true color, other than red is the true color. So truth is never known. What is that we see is an interaction. If there is sun's energy on that electromagnetic radiation, and if our eyesight is in the visible spectrum, then we can see. Night time you come and see in the pitch dark, can you see it as red? So truth is never known. It is what we perceive, so-called truth, is only interaction. I ask you to do some work, you will say yes. Oh, he is a very good person. You refuse tomorrow. So, what is that? We judge people because of our interaction. Is it the truth? Is good or bad? So also in science, what we perceive to be truth, I am not saying that, okay, it is not right. Please don't tell, quote outside, and then they will think that we are all, you know, should go to Thane hospital. But that's not what I mean. What I want you to go in deep is, real truth is unknown. What we hear, is at the end of the spectrum of audibility? What we see, is it the end of the spectrum of visibility? The whole from, you know, zero to infinity, there are many wavelengths. Can we see? We have our limitations. What we listen, what we see is only limited. Saying that beyond this room is all empty, this is the whole world, is something like that. So, what is finally, how do we go to that? Science and spirituality should go in search of reality to know the truth. What we perceive is only within our limits. That is what we perceive. Unless infrared was found, can anybody accept that it is infrared beyond visible spectrum? We can't. We can't listen many sounds, but does not mean they do not exist. So, the energy, both of them if you combine, that is what hc by lambda, that is where h is the Planck's constant, I have given the values, c is the velocity of light, lambda is the wavelength. That is what the quantum in joules will come. Radial spectral excitance as per the wavelength is m lambda is equal to, given by these radiative constants c1, c2, and lambda is given by that. That is, and that if you integrate between 0 to infinity, the total spectral radiant excitance m is given by sigma into t to the power of 4, where t is the temperature. And finally, the maximum wavelength at which the maximum transmission takes place is a by t, where a is a constant, 2898 divided by the, oh, yeah, this is it. So for sun, if you see, you can see 0.5. That is the maximum intensity. Whereas for this, the 2898 by 6000 gives you 0.5. 2898 divided by 300 approximately gives 10 microns, and that is what is called maximum wavelength of the transmission. And see that design or accident, we are in that spectrum of that maximum wavelength, maximum receiving the energy, and we are able to see in that. Okay, so what does the atmosphere influence in terms of absorption, in terms of scattering? Okay, what is reflected is what we see, right? Finally, that's what is detected. So absorption I have talked about, what absorbs the thing. What is scattering? Rayleigh, my non-selective scatter. What is a Rayleigh scatter? If the interfering particle is less than the wavelength, that is called Rayleigh scatter. If my scatter is almost the same, the particles have same sizes, the wavelengths of for the interaction, and the non-selective scatter, the particles have most size. Non-selective scatter is the water droplets and all that. This will be a overcast sky, and that Rayleigh scatter is the one which normally, what is the best example of Rayleigh scatter? How does the sky look? Sky looks blue. But in the early morning and late evening, why is it so? Why is it looking blue? Why is it in red? And why not some other color? Scattering. Scattering is that is blue lights get scattered, so it looks blue. In the early morning and evening, it is so complete that even the long wave radiation will get. So that is how that is red. Fine. Now, but if that, what are the seven colors that has been, you know, you put a prism and split it up in class 10 or 11, we have done this experiment in the school. Yes or no? So how many colors? Seven colors. Can you name them? Bibgayer, right, GR, whatever it is. So first thing is violet, second is, third is, we'll stop there. So, but sky is looking blue. Why it should not look violet? Why it should not look indigo? One, two. Why did it choose third one? Wavelengths only, but the shorter wavelengths, Rayleigh scatter is, shorter wavelengths get scattered. Why is it so? Any answer? Answer lies again, our eyes, you know, it is called the primary colors are RGB. But why only RGB? Who found seven colors of white light being split? It's the Newton's. All his discoveries are at the age of 21 or so. Later on, he became a mint employee and did not do much, but was the great thing that he has done. So, what is it I was asking you? Yes, why sky should not look violet or indigo? Yes, any questions? Any answers? Because eye is sensitive to blue, green and red. These cones are much more, comparatively green is even higher than blue and red. And the other color perception becomes difficult because very few cones are there. That's why we feel the primary colors are RGB, people say, but it is not. The main important colors are, we can split into seven, it should be seven. But the number of cones that are present to discriminate that particular color is quite less. So we say RGB, that is what it is. Okay? So that's why sky looks blue, because although it should have been looking violet or indigo, but because our perception. That is why even in seven colors, we can't discriminate all of them most of the time. Yes or no? So that is the reason for that. So when the light strikes, it is all incident energy. What is reflected energy is, that is what can be detected. What gets absorbed, what gets transmitted is, you know, is what finally we talk about only reflected energy. Yes or no? So based on this reflected energy, if you draw for some of these important features like a bare soil, vegetation and water, at various wavelengths, you can see what is the percentage reflectance. These are called curves, reflectance curves for that particular feature. Can it be a signature? Spectral reflectance curves. Spectral signatures, can we say? At various wavelengths, you can see how it is. Okay, vegetation we take. Ups and downs is vegetation. You can see in the visible, it is something like this. Can you see? Please see there. In the infrared, it goes up. You can see, no? There. And then here, again, it comes down and slightly it goes up and comes down. And what is it due to? These are all, you know, this is green. So green, it is okay. But what happens is chlorophyll presence in infrared, the reflected energy is so much because of the chlorophyll presence, that is how it shoots up in near infrared. And similarly, there are some water bands where it comes down because of the absorption. And then it goes. So you can see reflectance curves, spectral reflectance curves gives an idea about how the material behaves. Based on these curves, you can detect the type of objects. That is all what we do in film sense. Is it okay? So, of course, this can we call it a signature? Spectral signature. Sometimes you hear this word, spectral signature. Can we say signature? Signature is unchangeable. Bank wala will ask. Nowadays is all ATM and all that. So, but otherwise, when you give a check, sir, your signature is not matching. Come and sign. With time, right? Everything changes. Yes or no? From black, thick hair to white, sparse hair with time. Yes or no? So, from the very good actor-like image to the old image. These are all part of the time. So also signature change. If it is unique, it can be called a signature. But otherwise, although some people call it as signatures, it's unchanging it should be. Or what happens? You take the extremities and take an average, ever a spectral reflectance curves or something you can call, because there is variation in terms of incoming energy, there is variation in terms of absorption, transmission, reflectance, and then the limitation of the detector. All these things. So you can't have absolute atmospheric conditions to be same always. It keeps changing from day to day, time to time. Yes or no? So you simply cannot say absolutely it will. That is what new thing that has come. I think I have wrote a sentence or two about hyperspectral signature. It is at about 300 bands in that visible and infrared. Here it is 1 micron, 2 micron, 3 micron itself. We feel, oh, it is such a narrow thing. But then 10 nanometers, you can imagine 286 bands in that image. So that gives little more about the minerals or something of that type. But that is, you know, how to process such a big data. That would be challenge, as we always feel we wanted to. If we don't have work, we say complicate things which are simpler. Yes or no? Yes. Otherwise, where is our survival? And then finally, what happens when it becomes complicated? We say it is too complicated, we should simplify. So we complicate, and then thinking that hyperspectral will give, yeah, it gives for a particular purpose. Then for general purpose, it may not be. Yes or no? So that is, so image acquisition can be done by photographic sensors. We are familiar. Digital data, that is what? The reflectance is being recorded. Okay? Not an image form in terms of reflectance values. And then finally, satellites. Of course, there are atmospheric satellites also. Right now, I have not included them because we are interested in this. You can see the difference between black and white photography and then infrared. Okay? That area, this white area, is what? Can you tell me? What would be this area? Which one?
Paved surface.
What is that in black and white? How does it look? So it is the, in black and white you can't see in color. So it is the lawns, vegetation. So that's why high reflectance. High reflectance means towards white or black? Right? You can see in color. Achha, this is a color processing of addition, subtraction. That is how all the three primary colors will give you about white. And in subtraction, in this is in case of, you know, the color positives. That we don't. You can see now in color. Color, natural color, color infrared. Color infrared, how does it come? In case of color composites also, blue, green, red are supposed to be primary colors. But although there are seven colors, right? Because of the cones, blue, green, red. So blue, whatever reflectance in blue and green and red, if you see, that is what it is, color, natural color. But green, red and infrared are represented in blue, green and red filters. That becomes infrared or color composite. normal color composite. Of course, you can change. So you can see the difference between the two. This is infrared. And then what is that in within the stadium? It looks same. What is it there also? It goes like a lawn almost, right? If I see only the top picture. So bottom picture? Huh? Yes, yes. Okay. Earlier we used to use hockey Olympics, but later on we felt that because we don't have AstroTurf, so we should have AstroTurf. So we have AstroTurf. AstroTurf looks like lawn, but in this infrared it doesn't, because it is not natural, so it doesn't come. And this is the greatest advantage of the infrared that got a flip in Second World War. First World War is the aerial photography itself, and that is it. So that you can camouflage things can be brought out. We really, they put the branches being cut and put, including soldiers, that can come out very clearly infrared. And that is, so some of the instruments which you can interpret are the mirror stereoscope, pocket stereoscopes, where you can see in 3D. Two photographs with 60% overlap, same area should be there, at least 60%. And that you can see in 3D. It's like Chota Chetan in 3D movie. Yes? What is it? You are given a glass, some color glass, and then you can see that superposition of one over the other. And when you wear those filters or glasses, you will see. Here it is 60% overlap is same. So you synchronize that, you should be able to synchronize and see will as one model. Then you can see in 3D. That is what is mirror stereoscope. And there are of course plotting instruments which you can see. I will not get into more details of that. So what is image interpretation? Image interpretation is based on this. Once you see in 3D, based on these are called elements of interpretation. So once you see in 3D, there are image interpretation: shape, size, pattern, tone, texture, shadow, sight, association. Okay? These are the elements of interpretation. Based on the shape, why do we call a pentagon building? The headquarters of the US Defense Establishment, because it is in the shape. So you can identify the shape. Size, whether it is a swimming pool or for something else, if you know the sizes, you can, right? Patterns is repetitive tonal changes. That is what is the pattern. So based on pattern, you should be able to. Of course, tone. Texture is of course the way tones are represented in repetition. Patterns is a particular pattern, a road. Normally you feel some width and lengths are more. Okay? Then shadows. A building, actually shadows will help you in interpretation. Without shadows, it is difficult sometimes. And the sight. If you know the site that you are interpreting, that will definitely help you. And association, associated features along with that, whether it is a water body is used for sports or is a tank for irrigation. If you have associated features around that, you have some lodges and all that where people can, then it must be recreation. So if there is nothing, that it is a water body, it could be used for that. Or if you have a dam that you see, fine. So with association, you can increase the capability of interpretation. There are various resolutions that we talk about. What are they? Spatial resolution, spectral resolution, radiometric resolution, and temporal resolution. Spatial resolution is in terms of the space. That means each pixel in the digital images, how much area it represents. That is what is called spatial resolution. And of course, the present day it is almost 1 meter, even 0.65 meters is the pixel size. Earlier, the first 60s, it was styros for atmospheric detection and this. And 1972, it was Landsat. And that has opened floodgates because space sciences and remote sensing joined together. And that is the evolution of all these present thing, IRS or Landsat 1, 2, 3, 4, SPOT 1, 2, 3, 4. And then, what is it, our IRS 1A, 1B, 1C, 1D, P5, at the present date is CartoSat, earlier to that but resources sat. So from 77, 76.5 meters to 36.25 meters to 23.5 meters to 5 meters and 2.5 meters is the order of the day in Indian satellite, civilian. At 2.5, I think they are not giving to everybody, but 5 meters, yes, anybody can get. So, whereas ArbView and these satellites have even 0.65 meters, that is what is called spatial resolution. Anything? And the spectral resolution is the bandwidth through which you are getting. In terms of multispectral, we have, you see, blue, green, red, infrared. If you have in TM, it is 7 bands including thermal. So that is, whereas in hyperspectral, 10 nanometers, continuously 10 nanometers. That is what is called spectral resolution. And radiometric resolution is, so from this completely white sheet, I get a reflectance, yes or no? And from completely black, also I may get something. Now, this is the quantum of energy difference between the two, what I get as reflected energy, yes or no? If that I can divide into how many bits, how many gray levels, how many shades, that is what is called radiometric resolution. So if it is a 7 bit, 2 to the power of 7 minus 1, to 8 bits is 2 to the power of 8 minus 1, not in 8, minus 1. So that becomes 255, 0 to 255, 0 is counted, so total becomes 256 shades of gray. So that many I should be able to do. So now the present day satellites have 10 bit, you can imagine 2 to the power of 10 minus 1. The earlier satellites were 6 bit, 7 bit. So that is in terms of 2. If it is binary, it is 0 and 1. If it is 2 bit, 2 to the power of 4 minus, so 0 to 3, 0, 1, 2, 3, like that. Okay, so that is what is called temporal resolution. So there is always, can you have the best of all? What is a better spatial resolution? Is it more or less in space? Less of space, less of spectral bandwidth, more number of gray shades, radiometric resolution, and temporal resolution is what? With respect to time. With respect to time, if I can have this revisit capacity for the same area, that is temporal resolution. How much it is, it depends on the satellite to satellite. It started with 13, 14, 18 days or so with Landsat. Now they can be tiltable, you know, sensors. With that you have much higher thing. It can be almost few days later. And that depends upon the orbital altitude. Same thing that is coming back without tilting. With tilting, you can even see the same area in due course. How does that, how do you decide in how many days does it take? If you see when the Indian satellite missions, they launch the satellite, so it is slotted into a particular orbit, if you say 816, 817, 700. It depends what is the pre-designed and what it is supposed to be, how much should be spatial resolution, all that, that decides. So based on this, you can say how much time it takes to revisit the same place and in how many, times, depending upon the how much area it covers in one go and when it comes back to that. It all depends upon this. You can calculate if you know the orbital height. Okay? So that is what is temporal resolution is being decided. Now, can I have best of all these resolutions? Yes or no? The least, that is the best spatial resolution, maybe now right now 0.65, okay, that or even less. Spectral resolution, now hyperspectral. Hyperspectral has 286 bands or even more with 30 meters, right now that is the thing. and then radiometric resolution, best 10 bits. So is it possible? All the best of all the worlds. Why? The quantum of energy that is received depends upon spectral resolution. If the bandwidth is more incoming energy can be there, yes or no? That is spectral resolution. And then spatial resolution. If the pixel dimension is more, can I get more reflectance? Instead of less, more means will it be more or not? So if you have less of spectral resolution, less of spatial resolution, can you get more energy? And depends on that radiometric resolution. Can it be possible, both of them? Then what happens if you have to really have that, then your sensor technology should improve. That is what Landsat 1, it was launched, it was, across track scanning, whereas CCDs were developed later. Almost every pixel is being independently looked by a CCD sensor. That is the later development. So why? Because signal to noise ratio should be high. Noise should be least, ideally zero. So that signal to noise ratio becomes infinity. So any quantum of energy that you give above a zero, it should get, you should be able to detect. But normally, is that the case? No, signal to noise, there is always a noise. Noise could be because of the other, pixels which are contributing. Yes or no? So, and atmospheric one, it is difficult. So their signal, that our objective should be signal to noise ratio should be less, and that is taken care by the designing of the sensors. So if the sensors are sensitive, you can go for this. If the sensors are not, then okay. So that optimal thing, that trade-off exists between spatial, spectral and radiometric resolutions, whereas temporal resolution is for you to decide depending upon putting the satellite in a particular orbit based on that formula. And what are called these, you see in a TV daily almost, they show the India and the cloud, say it's going to rain or something. Yeah, we have seen. Those are placed, they are called, what are they called? Are they resource satellites or some sort of resource, but it is atmospheric communication satellite. These Apple, we have satellites, our own. That is how we get, these transmission, phoning as well as internet, as well as the TV transmission is because of those satellites. They are called, these are the Earth resource satellites and they are called communication satellites. Any difference is there? Orbit rate will be more for height. For how much height it is? Communication satellites are supposed to be, it should be looking at the same point of the Earth always. So that means its rate of movement will synchronize with the rate of movement of the Earth. So what is the orbital time for a communication satellite then? 24 hours. You put hours and then that means in seconds and you can get the height. R is fixed for the Earth. That's it. Whereas others, that is really 47,000 to 48,000 kilometers. That is the height at which they should be slotted. Whereas these are all between 400, 500 onwards to 800, 900, like that. All Earth resource satellites. Because the orbital period is around 100 seconds, 90 seconds, like that. You can calculate. You put 817 or 800 kilometers, you will get around that. 900 kilometers gives you about 103 seconds.